I'd like to call this May 1st meeting of the Hampton City School Board to order. Ms. Bowers, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Harper?
Here.
Ms. Henry?
Here.
Mr. Kilgore?
Here.
Mr. Pearson?
Here.
Ms. Phillips?
Here.
Ms. Smith?
Here.
Ms. Mugler?
Here. Let the record show that all the members of the school board are present, along with our division superintendent, Dr. Linda Shiflett, and our school board attorney, Ms. Nancy Reeves, our clerk, Ms. Carolyn Bowers, and our student liaison, Mr. Javonte Blunt. And at this time, I'm going to turn things over to Mr. Blunt.
Today, our innovation and Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Destiny Dixon, who is an eighth grade student at Lindsay Middle School. Destiny.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I have a need to help others succeed. It is my deed to cautiously lead with dedication, my generation, to higher education through preparation for a competitive nation, laying the foundation for more cultivation of intelligence. I have an immense layer of patience for the ignorance of people who have potential to be essential to the consequential development and betterment of the environment of the community with the opportunity to enforce unity. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world.
And did you pick that out when you were out?
Yes, with me and my language arts teacher.
And who wrote that?
An eighth grade student named Whitney Kelly.
And you go to Lindsay, correct?
Yes.
Ivy program. What high school are you going to next year?
Hampton.
I knew it. What's your favorite subject?
Geometry.
Wow. All right.
Might have some problems. I didn't like geometry.
Yeah.
Did you bring your family along?
Yes.
Could they stand and be recognized? And your principal of Lindsay is also here. Could you stand and be recognized?
Her language arts teacher is here too, Ms. Briscasta on eighth grade.
Mr. Harper?
Destiny, very good job, dear. I tell you, with a name like Destiny, it fits you. Whoever named you that knew exactly what they were doing, so you don't let them down, all right?
Thank you.
We'll see you up here in a few more years. Destiny.
Yeah, we loved that powerful delivery. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Did you get to get out of school a little bit early?
Yes.
Awesome.
Good job.
We move along to our consent agenda with items 2.10 and 2.02. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move approval of our consent agenda.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that we approve today's consent agenda, and I was drawn to my attention to add item 2.03 to that as well. It's not showing up on my screen because I brought it up earlier, I think, before the meeting started.
It's up there.
Okay, but it's not on my screen.
It came up a little bit.
Okay. So anyway, it's been moved and seconded that we approve today's consent agenda. Is there any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, would you call for the vote?
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. We move to superintendent and staff report. So I'll turn things over to you, Dr. Shiflett.
Well, thank you, Ms. Mugler. I think tonight is the Vic Hellman show, and we have a series of reports from various facets of his department. The first report is on the Wythe Elementary School reuse planning process. Dr. Hellman?
Thank you, Dr. Shiflett, Madam Chair, Vice Chair Kilgore, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here with you this evening. On September of 2010, as you all are aware, we opened the doors to Hampton's two new schools, Hunter B. Andrews and George P. Phoenix. Going back a few months to June of 2010, we unfortunately closed the doors on a chapter of Hampton history, and that was the closing of the George P. Wythe Elementary School. There's been a lot of discussion as to what we may or may not want to do with that facility, and we're working with the city to seek public input so that we can come to the school board and make a recommendation as to what the final outcome of that facility might be. With us tonight is Mr. Jonathan McBride from the Community Development Department with the City of Hampton, and as soon as I can bring it up, he's going to run through the process that we're getting ready to undertake.
Okay, great. Good evening, Mr. McBride.
Thank you, Madam Chair and fellow school board members. My name is Jonathan McBride. I'm with the Community Development Department, as Dr. Hellman said. I'm actually in the Housing and Neighborhoods Division, which is not, so I'm not a city planner, so just want to put that out on the table first. but a lot of our role is to help design the process around the community engagement side, ensuring that we've got some community input and developing that. It's nice, I will mention, to see my former principal here, so this is an odd Mr. Pearson. It's good to see you. So just the Wythe Elementary School, as Dr. Hellman mentioned, it was a school that was closed 3 years ago, and so there's been some community interest in the school, obviously, and what's going to happen with that. And so our first, we're going to kind of give you a little bit of an overview, the broad picture of what the process is, and then mention about a community meeting that we have scheduled in a few weeks to kind of gauge what that current sentiment is. So we've been discussing since December. January with staff, just kind of developing that process. What's it like now? Gathering some information. What's the building's current status? What's around the property? As you know, the property also includes the George Wythe Little League, as well as the playground that was a community project several years ago, as well in the tennis court, former tennis courts, I guess you could say, in the corner there at Claremont and Kickatan. So we're really talking about a bigger area that's involved in this discussion around the site. So we want to make sure we include that. This also is in the Kickatan Corridor Master Plan. So this area is involved in that. So that's part of the information gathering. What does the master plan currently say? How do we incorporate that into future discussions? So right now we're in the information gathering stage. The next step is going to be a community input as part of the information gathering, and that's on May the 16th, which I'll talk about a little bit more in a minute in more detail. Next, we'll be taking that information back. The planners will be doing some analysis of what they heard, how that matches up with what's the current existing conditions of the community, what maybe some other interests and some other possibilities for reuse, and they'll be bringing back for a final recommendation to the school board, and they'll be checking in with you along the way. So you'll be getting feedback on what happens with the community meeting, as well as what other possibilities before they start examining those. So that's the big picture. As we go into the community meeting for May the 16th, this is at Armstrong Elementary School. We have at 6 o'clock, 6 to 7:30. I will say the capacity for the building is about 200 is what we've usually done for these meetings, and it wouldn't be a surprise to have 200 people at this meeting. We've had meetings in the past in this area around other master plan projects that have been to capacity. That would be a good problem. We will be glad to have follow-up meetings if that's needed. So if anybody can't get in for that night, we'd be glad to have them at a follow-up meeting. And on the turn side, if we don't have a great turnout, we want to make sure that we do enough outreach. So we'll do an additional meeting, other online outreach if we have to ensure that we're getting the community feedback. And that's kind of where my role and our department serves, is to make sure we're getting the community feedback that's really representative of the community, both the immediate impacted area as well as you know, with elementary school being open for 100 years, we were there in July of 2010 for a community celebration. We had people from around the region that had interest in the school, so we want to make sure that we've got good representation around the school and the site. So as I mentioned, Armstrong Elementary School at 6 p.m. And just to kind of give you an idea of what's going to happen that evening, school board and planning representatives are going to be sharing a little bit of a breakdown of the overview, kind of background of where the site is, where we are today, some of the fiscal constraints that may be impacting decisions in the future, because we want to make sure that people are giving input and they're informed about the input that they're giving. And then we're going to be breaking off into three kind of table topic areas around these three elements: history and character. We're asking them around what are their key, what are some significant features around history and character that we may not know about. We're going to share some of the basic history and character elements that we may know, you know, the school's history, some of the beloved owls that are there that we know of, that around the character of the building, and this is the architecture of the building that's very unique. But we also want to know from the community what's important to them. What are some of the, you know, maybe somebody that played on the baseball field years ago, or maybe someone who went to school there that's really important to Hampton's history. So we'll be asking that, as well as the recreation and access. That's really going to focus on the larger site. So we, like I said, there's a Little League there. There's some other activities there. What's the recreational activities around the site that are important to the community? What are some things that maybe they've always wanted there they hadn't figured out how to make that work? So what's the key things that are important to them around recreation, and maybe even safety would fall into that in the access. Is that safe? Does it feel safe around in that area? What are those key elements? The last one is the public, private, and partnership. And this is one that we're walking in delicately, because we know that there's interest in the community around this one of what's going to happen to the site. Is it going to stay a public facility? Is it going to be something that's going to be a private facility, or is it going to be something that's in partnership? And so we're going to be asking them what's the community's reaction. And as we typically say on planning processes, this is at the 60,000 foot level. These are the big picture topics, and we're going to have facilitators at each of these groups to really encourage them to keep those ideas at that level, rather than getting down into the details of what's the programming for the site, what's the deals, or how's the who's going to be there, what things are going to be there. We're going to really keep it at a higher level. What are the key big picture ideas around the site? And we're trying not also to get a laundry list of wish list either, because we know that that's not something we can, that's not a reality that we live in. So we're really trying to keep that set in reality. And then lastly, we'll give some next steps. So we'll follow up with the community again on this process towards the end with the final recommendation to you. So that's really in a nutshell. And the outreach, we'll be reaching out next week to the neighborhood organizations. We'll be giving a few of the neighborhood leaders an overview of the process so that they're aware, and get some feedback from them so if we need to make any changes before we walk in the room, we're prepared for anything, or at least the major stuff we may not have seen. We'll be doing a direct mail to the area. Probably, I think we have about 800 homes that we've targeted in the direct mail area that'll be notified of the meeting, as well as through e-news and Facebook and the neighborhood associations and their network. So we're really trying to do our best to really cast a broad net on the outreach so that people have an opportunity. And then, like I said, that's as process goes, that's the first step. And then we'll be following up with you as far as next step based on the feedback and the elements that we hear. So any questions or concerns I can help you with?
Awesome. Ms. Phillips?
Yes.
I just wanted to, I live over in that area, and my boys have played ball over it with, so every time I go out there, people ask me, what's going to happen to that school? Mm-hmm. What's going to happen? And you're right, the people over there, they will come out like you've never seen, because they're very, very passionate about their neighborhood. So you will get a lot of good input from that meeting. So I look forward to it.
I did forget to mention our mailers are going out this Friday, so everyone will be getting those later this weekend. That hasn't gone out yet, but that will be going out this Friday.
That'll go to residents in that area?
To the residents, yes. And we defined an area. Planning typically defines it based on natural features, mm-hmm. But we're also trusting on the neighborhood association to get it, neighborhood associations out there to get it beyond to the larger area.
Other questions from board members?
Yeah, quickly.
Mr. Harper?
Sir. Real quick. Vic, to your recollection of time, which school is the oldest, Armstrong or with?
Armstrong.
And we're having a meeting at Armstrong to determine the fate of with. Where's the next one going to be? Rhetorical. Good report, my man.
Thank you so much for your work on this with us. We look forward to hearing some results from the meetings.
Thank you. There's one other item I did want to thank the board on. We have an event coming up on Saturday for the Hampton Home Repair Blitz. I just want to thank the school board and Jane Bryan Elementary School for all the help that they've given us on this. Mrs. Smith and her husband are going to be team leads out there organizing a couple volunteers. So I just want to thank you for that. We're going to have over 230 volunteers rehab or taking care of the exterior of about 18 homes in one day. So it's a very successful project we started last year. This is our third one. Last time we were able to do Tyler Elementary School in the fall as our kind of host site, and Jane Bryant's doing this one. So we just want to, because I thank the school system for helping out and being a good partner in this. And we look for welcome to have you out there. We're doing our kickoff at 8:30 at Jane Bryant Elementary School on Saturday morning. We'd be glad to have you. So thank you.
Well, Mrs. Smith and her husband with their engineering backgrounds are perfect for that task. Mm-hmm. Got some capable hands. Going to give you some help. Dr. Shiflett?
Our next report is an update on school safety. Dr. Hellman?
Yes, ma'am. As soon as we can, there we go. We in the city of Hampton have an enviable position with our relationship with the Hampton Police Department. They do provide us SROs. And most recently, we've entered into a agreement. We have a memorandum of understanding between the school division and the Hampton Police Department regarding the services that the school resource officers will be providing to us. That's not the only level of security we have. We, of course, have our school security officers. And so to kind of give a broad overview of our school safety, Mr. Tim Grimes is going to give the report tonight, and he will introduce staff and various members of the Hampton Police Department who are with him tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Hellman. Well, good afternoon, Ms. Mugler and Mr. Kilgore, members of the board, Dr. Shiflett. I want to thank you for the opportunity to briefly update you on our school safety efforts here in Hampton City Schools, and to introduce you or reintroduce you to our lead officers with the Hampton Police Division. And I do want to take a moment just to introduce some of our staff members that are here this afternoon. First of all, I'd like to recognize our security supervisor, Mr. James Bailey, our lead security officer, Mr. Warren James, and in a few moments you'll be hearing from Corporal Titus Sapp, his partner, Corporal Nakia Clark. Somewhere in the auditorium is our senior patrol officer, John Healy, and Officer Master Patrol Officer Soriano, and his canine partner Franco, who you'll get to meet in a moment as well. Just briefly, I want to remind you that our emergency response plan is a web-based plan that follows National Incident Management System model, and there's a slide of that. Currently, our school administrators are using both our flip chart booklets and transitioning into the web-based plan so they become more familiar with that. And yearly we're required to do an update with you regarding the emergency response plan, and we will be doing so again in August of this year. But our emergency response plan follows a flow chart and checklist system that is easily accessible by the administrator, so that in a critical incident, it serves as a good reminder of the steps they're supposed to be taking, making sure that something is not overlooked in the process of their response, everything from identification through action, and in the end, how to debrief and learn from the various incidents that they have to work with. Also do need to update you on several new requirements to school security and couple of the code sections that will be coming into effect in this school year, or in July rather. The first one is 22.1-137.2, which will now require that each school does two lockdown drills during the school year, one in September, one in January. For the past 6 years, however, Hampton City Schools has been requiring our schools to do two lockdown drills. We actually do one announced lockdown drill with students near the beginning of the school year, and that sometime during the year they also will do an unannounced lockdown drill so that students are familiar with the emergency process if and when one were to occur. And occasionally, schools do have to go into what we call a modified lockdown. If there's some critical incident in the community and the police department, the police division advises us to, we simply lock the doors and control the access and of anybody coming to the school. So students are fairly familiar with the lockdown process within the school. Secondly, new code section, or in addition to code section 22.1-279.3.1, is going to require that schools have a walkthrough inspection, and there will be a checklist designed by the Virginia Center for School Safety that has not been produced as of yet, but will be forthcoming, hopefully during the summer. And this checklist will reflect the current objectives of the school safety audits, which we do every year, and submit to the Virginia Center for School Safety. It'll just allow our administrators to do quick walkthroughs, and in addition to that, and we will be doing that because of our partnership with the police division, the results of those checks would be submitted to the chief of police. These safety audits will follow the guidelines also that are established through the crime prevention through environmental design, or what's called SEPTED, which really looks at your physical plant of your building as well. And then lastly, because of the event that occurred almost 2 years ago, when Virginia didn't see the necessity we were not experiencing earthquakes, and we did have a significant one, of course, in the summer of 2011, we did conduct our first earthquake drill back on October 18th of 2012. At this point, what I'd like to transition and turn the podium over to Corporal Sapp as he talks about our partnership with the Hampton Police Division.
Good evening, Corporal.
Good evening, how y'all doing?
Great.
My name is Corporal Sapp. I'm here this evening to speak about the partnership that we have with the MOU. Originally, First Sergeant Barlewski was supposed to make this presentation, but she was unable to make it. So here I stand. Yeah. I'm going to read this, and hopefully we can understand everything that's going on here. For years, Hampton City Schools and the Hampton Police Division have had an excellent working relationship and one of the strongest police and school partnerships in the state. However, until recently, we have not had a formal and essential memorandum of understanding. We felt that it was important to have the MOU to clearly outline the roles and responsibilities of the SRO and the Hampton City School Building Administrators. This agreement was signed and has been in effect since April 1st, 2013. I'm going to give you a few highlights of the MOU. It defines the school and police partnership. The purpose of the School Resource Officer Program. It also describes the objectives of the School Resource Officer Program, the outline roles and responsibilities for the SROs and the building administrators. Also the chain of command, supervision, and the communication between both Hampton City Schools and Hampton Police Department. Funding and resources, reporting procedures, and the evaluation process. This endeavor is a partnership between education and law enforcement, which supports a joint proactive approach to providing a safe school environment for the Hampton City Schools and Hampton Police Division through the SRO program. I would like to take this opportunity to introduce my new counterpart. She was recently married here. This is Corporal Peak. Would also like to introduce MPO Soriano, who has Franco. That's our little narcotic dog who goes through the schools at the time we do the searches. We also have Officer Jennerette. She is also friendly. And then also we have for our truancy officer, Officer Healy, who y'all are very familiar with because he's here for every board meeting. We currently have 12 SROs permanently assigned in middle schools and high schools. All of the officers in the program are dedicated individuals who mentor, counsel, and provide safety to the children and staff of the Hampton City Schools. They take pride in their position, and recently we have designed a pin. Actually, it was Officer Davis designed a pin to show how dedicated we are to the Hampton City Schools. And I'm not quite sure if we have a slide of that pin. Okay, we have a pin. It's a badge with an apple in it, and it's been approved for us to wear on our uniforms, so that people know that, you know, we're here to support the schools, and it's just a good representation of what we do in the schools.
Officer Sapp, what would be the possibilities of somebody getting one of them badges there with that apple in it?
Oh, we have some.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
I would like to add that the additional services that are highlighted on this slide are beyond the normal scope of a school resource officer program. The chief of police historically has seen the importance of providing solid leadership for the officers. Therefore, two full-time corporals are dedicated to our school resource officer program, mm-hmm. officer friendly. Of course, Officer Healy works full-time with our schools, working on our attendance issues with families. And of course, Officer Soriano and Franco have been last year they were a recent addition to our unit. So it's been these are additional assets that provide a great deal of safety for our students and staff at school. I would like to also invite our school security supervisor, Mr. James Bailey, to the podium to share with you some elements of our school security officer program.
Good evening. First, I want to introduce Mr. Warren James, my lead security officer. He's dedicated, works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, along with me. Here to mentor students, work with the administration out here, and does an excellent job, and just want to commend him for his work too as well. We currently also have 35 full-time school security officers, school employees, that work in our middle schools and high schools and alternative schools. They do an excellent job day in and day out. Sometimes it's a challenging job as a school security officer, but they handle it very well, mentor students and work with parents and staff members to ensure the safety of our schools on a daily basis out here. I want to thank them also for their work. For next year, we are going to go back to a uniform style shirt for all security officers, including our sub security officers. We have approximately 10 subs that fill in when our full-time members aren't able to make it. This is the design that it'll look like. Security officers had a little bit of say in the shirts that they chose, and there'll be a solid black wick shirt. And another reason we want to go back to that is to have as high visibility throughout the schools during the daytime, to let parents know that they are out here monitoring the schools and doing checks on the doors and camera systems and things like that. So our school security officers are also DCGS certified. They're mandated to go through a 32-hour block of training initially when they're hired on. That Warren, Mr. James, and I provide training to actually here at Jones Magnet Middle School. And then they're required to maintain in-service training 16 hours within every 2 years. Briefly, we do have a state safety conference that's here in Hampton every year that DCGS puts on. They have state national speakers. And to show you the dedication to some of our security officers, it's a non-contract event during the summertime that they're not with the school division, but we have approximately 20 security officers that came forward on their own time to attend these conferences to be able to network with other school security officers and law enforcement officers throughout the state and nation. So they are dedicated out here to stay on top of the best training that they can. So thank you for that.
I would just like to add this training that our school security officers receive. Mr. Bailey and Mr. James are state certified trainers, and that saves us a significant amount of money every year that they do the training in-house. Not every school division has that people with their skills and qualifications to provide that, and therefore the officers have to be sent away for state training at a great deal of cost to the school division. So Mr. Bailey and Mr. James are excellent at providing that and keeping that training ongoing and making sure that those training records are up to date and that our security officers are all remain certified. At this time, I'd like to entertain any questions that you all may have, either for our security department or for the police division.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Grimes. And thank you, officers, for the report. We truly value the partnership that we have with Hampton Police Division and all of the officers that work in our schools. Any questions from board members? Mrs. Henry?
Just a comment. The professionalism of the SROs and the security officers is impressive, but what is the most impressive, perhaps, and the thing that helps us be the safe, help students establish a community of safety, is the trust and the rapport and the relationships they build with young people. Not only, I think initially the SROs thought, well, we're going to find out about some kids that are out in the community that we'd like to know some more about. And there's a little bit of that. But more importantly, the young people get to know police officers and they realize their respect and regard for the young people. And the thing that can keep the school the safest is for the student to say, I'm really worried about Johnny because he seems very angry, and can you talk to him? And that kind of relationship is one of the foundations of safety in schools. And I also wanted to add, because Franco reminded me, that we have an awful lot of other resources that come from the police department with regard to school safety, because in addition to having the narcotics inspection, we do we have the gun dogs that can do guns and explosives, and they check out schools from time to time. They also check out the Coliseum for graduation. They check out the stadiums, lots of other things that are provided to keep our students safe.
You're absolutely correct, Ms. Henry. And one thing that you are probably not aware of, Franco is actually a Hampton City Schools employee. He was purchased with some grant funds that were made available to us. Officer Soriano is kind enough to take care of and feed Franco, but he is actually your narcotics dog.
I actually got to see Franco when he was, I think, first year. Is that right, Officer Soriano? And he has grown. And he looks a little more ferocious now. Well, could you come up a minute and tell folks the breed of dog, because it's not a German Shepherd.
Belgian. He is 3 years old.
He's a form of Belgian Malinois. We've never had him in the Hampton Police Division. First time we've ever used him. He came from overseas. He has a tattoo in his ear still from, from transferring over. High energy dog. We go out there and do searches. He doesn't get tired. See, I get tired. Yeah. but he's really fun, and it's an experience. Working with this particular dog, I've usually worked with traditional shepherds, a little slower, a little more methodical. He has to go. But he does his thing. He just turned three, and he's been working well.
Aww. He certainly is a beautiful dog.
He's a lot more protective now.
Uh-huh.
You got the police thing going on.
So is it Officer Franco now?
It's Officer Franco.
Okay, got it.
He's in charge.
Aww.
Just drop him around.
Thank you.
Daisy.
Any other questions or comments from board members on this report? Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Grimes, and officers, and our resident experts over here, Mr. Bailey and Mr. James.
I do have to say that we have some of the most dedicated staff in school security that I've ever seen, Mr. Bailey and Warren James. An amazing duo. There's absolutely no time that I've ever called them and not had an immediate response. And I just want to thank you for all you do to help keep Hampton City Schools safe. All right. Our next report is our CIP report. Dr. Hellman.
Yes, ma'am. Madam Chair, board members, about this time each year, Mr. Sawyer will give his State of the Union address in terms of what type of projects and what we're looking to do as we move forward. This year, the city has financed and moved forward with the funding that we were to receive up through the end of fiscal year 13. So we've got about $9.1 million that we're working with this year in bond funds, along with some of the other monies that Mr. Sawyer has in his regular operating budget. So with that, I'll go on ahead and turn it over to Mr. Sawyer, and he'll walk you through those things that we're looking forward to doing this summer.
Thank you, Dr. Hellman.
Oh, hi, how are you?
Hi.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, and Dr. Shufflet. Always my pleasure and privilege to be here and present the CIP. And I'm going to share with you not only our plan, the improvements for this summer, but some of the things we've done in the past 9 months. But I'm going to open with just a brief overview of school security to kind of follow up with what Mr. Grimes had presented to the board. The administration is currently looking very seriously at school security, as Mr. Grimes has demonstrated. But to further demonstrate our resolve, we're looking at electronic security. We've had security cameras and motion detectors for a number of years, but we want to go to the next step, which involves controlled access to the buildings. Currently, school administrators rely pretty much on the manual operation of locks to keep doors locked, but I think the administration is seriously considering moving to the next level, which is electronic access control. So we are currently working with a number of vendors and designs to enhance our schools to secure the entryway to each school. There are a number of issues that we have to deal with, but we're addressing the video surveillance portion, the communication piece that has to be established between the door and someone in the office. And if you look at this slide, which is difficult to see, I know, but it just basically shows some of the basic hardware that's involved. You would have a station by each entry door, and we would identify a primary entrance at a school. And it would have typically it's a push button or a motion activated system built in with a video camera. So the occupants in the building would be able to establish some identification or visual contact with a person coming in the building. In addition, it's going to be web-based. So we're able to add and delete authorized users to the system almost within seconds. Our recommendation is to use the school badge that we currently have and embed this with a chip, so it's a proximity reader, in lieu of a swipe. So basically within a few inches, you've activated the locks or deactivated the locks. We are going to maintain the internal security, which is our motion and door contacts. We feel like that's a necessary second level of protection, particularly after hours, in case somebody was to violate the main entry door. We still have the cameras going in our internal motion detectors. So I know we're working with our administration and administrators on this issue, and we hope to have something more detailed and solid to offer you in the near future. So if we move on to our CIP projects, if you recall, actually the first slide, we were very proud of Kecoughtan High School, the auditorium renovation that recently occurred. And this year, we were pleased to get the funding to move ahead with Spratley and Sims Auditorium. The level of improvements will equal that of our other schools, where we address sound and lighting and flooring, seats, the painting. I think you'll be real pleased. Two very old schools, very similar in design. So we look forward to get that project started very soon. This is a before, and so sometime later this school year or next school year, we'll revisit this picture and kind of compare it to the renovation. A recent project that we've undertaken is, and this is probably not the best slide, but it's a window replacement, but it is very typical of many of our schools. These are original aluminum frame windows, single pane, and we have a number of issues which we address just broken hardware, security, The energy efficiency is very poor, and that was recently substantiated by an engineering study. So we think there are a lot of gains, and we've actually elevated this to a higher priority. So we're going to start this year at Tucker Capps and Phillips. Again, we tried to maximize the use of the design. These schools are basically the same, so that reduces your overall design cost and hopefully will improve the installation process. So we are just about wrapped up on our design, and we look forward to moving ahead with this. There's a number of roofing projects which are going to occur throughout the division. And Armstrong, as we talked about earlier, a 1922 building, that's not the original roof, but it is about 25 years old and has reached the end of its useful life. In addition to the roofing problems, we know there are masonry issues and drainage issues along the roof and the gutters. So we've asked the architect to make sure that was included, which it was, and part of the overall design. So we're very anxious, and we know it's overdue, so we look forward to that improvement. It's two other schools, which, if you recall, we have completed phase one at Lindsay and Sims. And this particular photo will show the difference between the new and the old. The white reflective surface in the background and the phase two, which is the forefront, which is a gravel built-up roof. So that has been awarded, and we anticipate that start very soon. And yet another roof at Eaton Middle School. Again, we did phase one last year. So we're looking forward to the replacement of the instructional area, which is this viewpoint of the old roof. One of the probably single biggest projects is the air conditioning replacement in Hampton High School. And this, again, is long overdue. We've had issues with the air conditioning system, unfortunately, for some time. And this photo probably doesn't do justice to the scope of work, but those units are quite large. There's individual units in each classroom, and it will require a crane to get them up to the second floor. And it also requires taking out part of the wall, the exterior wall, just to get the old units in and get the new units in. And the new units in. We've awarded this project, and it's also going to be coupled with some overall improvements for the classrooms as far as ceiling and lighting and painting and flooring. So it's a very extensive project on that entire second floor. But we're working close with our contractors and the administration at Hampton, so we're feeling very confident and look forward to that project as well. Aberdeen Elementary improvements on the driveway is going to be a continuation of a design philosophy we adopted some years ago. And basically the philosophy is we try to segregate buses and parent drop-off private vehicles. Right now at Aberdeen it's very difficult, and Mr. Harper, you probably know all about this at Aberdeen. It's difficult to get private cars in when you have school buses because you have a limited area to work with. So we have a design that's been completed and approved, and basically we're going to create a student drop-off on the right side of the building. So if you come off Aberdeen Road, you turn right and go to the rear of the building, and there will actually be a loop built in, much like you have at Asbury and some of our other schools. So I think that's long overdue and will be a great improvement. And we're also going to add a few extra parking places as well. This is a engineer's design, and I know it's difficult to see, but basically the dark shaded area represents the driveway in the loop that's going to occur to the right side of Aberdeen. Forest Elementary is one of our oldest elementary schools, and this is an original flooring in that cafeteria at Forest, and it's been on their list of improvements for several years, and this year we are in a position to move ahead. We had actually done the ceiling a couple of years ago, and we want to go ahead and complete the process, and they will be getting a new floor put in. Secondary restrooms in general have been an item of a lot of interest last couple of years, and we recognize there's a great need. We want to thank the superintendent because she heartily endorsed some of the things that took place last year. If you had a chance to go to some of our high schools and middle schools, you would see this. You saw the old and the new, and this is very typical of what we've been able to do in the restrooms, and so we want to continue that effort at a number of schools. We've already started at Bethel, and we'll continue the process in several other locations this summer. and here we are. We regret and apologize that this form is not complete. I'll just say there were a number of code issues and design issues that had to be resolved, and they have been resolved, and so we are now able to go out to bid. So when we meet in September, I'll go out on a limb. September, I hope that we are well into this process, and we'll have an enclosed, aesthetically pleased location for your meetings. This should be a familiar site. This is Barron Elementary, which is, you know, about a year old now, and that's typical of many of our schools where we enclose, well, this particular one had the enclosed breezeway. But before, it was an open breezeway connecting two wings of the building. And this was the dedication ceremony. And this is Carrie, which actually, can you flip back and just kind of give you some idea, you know, before and after. That was Barron Elementary. And even though the next slide is Carey Elementary, it could have been Barron, or it could have been Tucker Capps, or one of our other schools that had the same footprint. So this summer, designs have been completed, and we're looking forward to starting the enclosure at Carey Elementary. And the design would be very close to what you saw at Barron. The main difference will probably be the roof line. If you'll notice, this has a hip roof, more of a schoolhouse look, I guess you could say, as opposed to a flat roof that Barron had. So this is a conceptual drawing. Again, it mirrors pretty close to what we have at Barron. And of course, we will include all the latest security upgrades in this as well. So that represents, I think, most of the CIP projects we have planned, or the major projects at least, at this point. But the period, people ask me, what do you do between September and June? Well, other than the 12 to 13,000 work orders, we do a few other things. And you heard Mr. McBride and Dr. Hellman talk about WITH Elementary. So we kind of partnered with the city and the administration to move into WITH to make sure the building was at least free of any clutter or debris. We also used WITH, as you recall, as a storage area. And in the next slide, you're going to see this was the school auditorium, which is basically loaded with various books and recycled materials. And we were very successful in recycling this material. So we don't want to convey the idea that everything went to the dump. In fact, there was quite a few efforts made between auctions and recycling. And finally, we took what was left to the salvage, to salvage the metals. So it was a huge effort on the part of our department and some others. This, again, was the auditorium. I think the next slide was a typical classroom. And we did have buyers after an auction come and buy these desks. So we were happy to move that material out. But at the end of the day, our auditorium is basically clean and free of debris or any other material, salvageable materials. So we were happy to be a part of that effort and clear out WITH Elementary. And this is the classroom after the materials have been removed. If you recall last year, we talked briefly about a drainage water problem at Spratley Gifted Center. And it had been ongoing. It was really part of a design issue for that school where the windows and the masonry was actually below grade. So when you had heavy rain and flooding, it would back up. It was actually graded wrong. And we often experienced water inside the building. So we basically raised or shortened the windows, you might say, and raised the masonry and added several layers of waterproofing membrane against the wall and also put in some new piping system. So knock on wood, I haven't heard anything adverse, and I think we were successful in hopefully curing that problem. And we had some masonry issues at Asbury Elementary. For whatever reason, we're not quite certain why, but part of the brick veneer had come loose from the wall in the structure, and it did pose a potential hazard. And so we worked with an engineering firm, and we had the contractors out, and we secured that about, I think, 2 months ago. And one of the improvements we were able to do was at Lindsay Middle School. The heating equipment had failed early in the summer, actually, we determined it, and it was beyond repair. So we took the opportunity not only to replace the heating equipment, but Lindsay never had air conditioning in the gymnasium. So we wanted to move ahead and not only replace the heat, but at the same time, we came up with a design that's very similar to what we've used at Bethel and Hampton. And so now Lindsay Middle School has heat and air for the whole gymnasium. We're currently working with a problem at Phoebus, which it's, you might consider like opening Pandora's box. It started with a roof leak, and it just got worse and worse. And this is part of the berm, the earthen berm that surrounds the building. And I know Ms. Henry probably has some fond memories of that, but I think we're at the bottom of it now. And in addition to the leak problems, other things surface. I mentioned the roof. There were some foundation issues. There was some drainage issues at the base. And also, if you'll notice, there were no steps. That's a designated exit at the top of that hill. And for whatever reason, they never had steps to allow people to exit the building. I guess you slide down the hill. So our designs are complete, and the anticipation is we'll have that wrapped up, you know, with a safe exit to the building. Plus, we've made numerous repairs to the roof. In the next slide, you'll see an expansion joint, which is over 200 feet long. That's been completed, and in addition, we did some areas over the theater. So quite a bit of work went into Phoebus, and we are nearing completion over there. Burbank is another job that started out small. Basically, it was a pothole in the parking lot. But as we got deeper into that, we determined, you know, in fact, it was a drainage issue, and then it got worse as we followed the piping out to the city drainage system. They discovered some concrete had been basically dumped in the line at some point in time. And so we ended up, you know, not only replacing the pothole, but a new drain in the middle of the parking lot, and a substantial amount of piping was installed and the obstructions were removed. And as of yesterday, I know the last 2 days we've had a significant amount of rainfall, and so far so good. So that was a good project. We recently put in 2 new cooling towers. At Bethel and Eaton. Both the cooling towers, the bottoms had basically deteriorated and we lost a substantial amount of water. And that project is complete and both schools are operating without problem. Our technology people, as you recall, we closed Bridgeport last year. And so the relocation of our technology group, it was determined to move into Mallory, into the cafeteria. And so this photo shows the repair efforts, or basically the renovation efforts that were taking place at Mallory in the cafeteria. We basically gutted the building, or gutted that portion of the building. And this photo shows where we had painted. In addition, we put in new air conditioning. The old air conditioning was beyond repair and really ineffective based on their needs. So they now have overhead central air conditioning, and I think they're in a much better situation and seem to be doing well. And again, at Mallory, what I didn't mention is we moved the voters out of the cafeteria. So we had to give the voting folks a place for their precinct. So we went over across to the next wing, to the 200 wing, into the library, and this was basically what the library worked, what the library looked like before we got in there, lined with old carpet and bookshelves and dingy lighting. So after the improvements, now they have the painting, the lights, and new carpet. And in fact, I'm meeting with their new registrar next week, and we'll do a walkthrough, but I think they're in good shape for the next election. And that pretty much concludes the CIP, the safety, and some of the other projects we've done in the past 9 months. Again, this is Kickatan's auditorium, which we're very proud of. We also did Hampton and Davis that same year. So we're very, we're looking forward to doing the Sims and the Spratly as well. So I'd be happy to take any questions at this time.
Thank you, Mr. Sawyer, for your report. Okay. It's always amazing how many things you can do in such a short period of time. And I can say firsthand, the renovations in the auditoriums are awesome and incredible.
Thank
and
you.
Being
mm-hmm.
enjoyed by many. We look forward to seeing those changes in the middle schools.
Thank you.
Questions from other board members? Mrs. Henry?
Mm-hmm. I won't ask you if the theater wall still leaks at Phoebus, but How many schools, I know Phillips is like Cary, how many other schools are that design with the open breezeway that we need to go ahead and enclose for safety reasons?
All right, we currently, you mentioned Phillips, and we got campus at Lee. Mm-hmm. And, of course, we're currently getting ready to do Cary.
Right.
Tucker Cap.
2 years ago, Tucker Cap, excuse me. Now, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, we may have had Merrimack included and Mallory. But different purpose for those facilities right now. So, but yeah, the Tucker Caps, thank you. And the
so that's four more?
And the Phillips, yes.
Okay.
Asbury. And Asbury.
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 Asbury. Yeah.
Very good.
It's a different design, but it's the same problem.
It is.
Yeah. So they have to do some other design work. Hampton High School, I was in Hampton High School in 1986 with no air conditioning, so I know how old that that system is. But if we go through replacing all of it, is 25 years about all you can expect to get out of that kind of system?
Yes.
That's an expensive proposition.
It is.
25 years. Thank you.
Other questions from board members? We'll go right down the line. Mr. Harper?
Phyllis, that's the way those companies make money. They don't want to last forever. Tom, I'm always amazed, like Ms. Mugler said, at what you do with the resources you have. And I hope the city council and citizens of Hampton understand that we can't afford to lose any more money, which is why we requested what we did for our budget. The floor tile job at Forest.
Yes, sir.
Is that an abatement project?
Yeah, that's a 9-inch floor tile, and we typically bring in a company to take care of the abatement first, and then we'll come back with a new floor tile, yes.
All right, thank you.
Ms. Phillips?
I, too, have enjoyed the auditoriums. They're wonderful. I wanted to ask you about the restroom renovations.
Yes.
Do you know about how many schools y'all have done? I know I've been in Spratly, and I've been in Hampton.
We've done Davis.
Okay.
And like I say, we're currently in Bethel right now, and we want to move into Kickitan and Jones probably next.
Okay. That's what I was wondering if y'all had a priority list and, you know. So no way you can get them all done in one summer, huh?
No. Well, it's a fairly expensive undertaking, and it involves actually a lot of trades. There's a lot of demolition and tile work and partitions and plumbing and electrical and painting and doors. So it gets rather involved, but fortunately the schools, you know, if we have the funding, the schools have worked with us and they've allowed us to work during the school year. You know, we concentrate our efforts on one or two restrooms.
Yeah.
So, depending on the school, it doesn't disrupt their activities. But we're very pleased that some of the administrators allowed us to do that.
Well, the work that you've done, I mean, it's like night and day, and I can't wait to see what you do at Kickitan because they need help. Now, at Hampton, when you put this new AC in, will it make a difference in the hallways at all?
No.
I mean, I know you don't.
Yeah. Well, it's not designed to do the hallways that way.
Well, yeah, I knew that.
It's pretty much a self-contained unit, you know, designed for that classroom. And, of course, we encourage staff to keep the doors closed anyway for security purposes, and hopefully that will enhance the environmental conditions as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Mrs. Smith?
Yeah, I was wondering with the restrooms as well, because everybody's jealous of those new restrooms.
Oh, yeah.
So you said you're in Bethel now, and then the next is Kickitan and then Jones?
Yes.
And then you'll hopefully get more after that as you
Right. go. I mean, it's conceivable we will do more. Ms. Smith, we haven't received all of our final bids on particular jobs, so we may well have, depending on the availability of funding and the cooperation of administrators, which has been very good, it's very possible we could move even beyond what we are looking at right now.
Right, right. And I was wondering, you were talking about the parking at Aberdeen. Was there any mention of Jones or Cooper now that they're having to do their own transportation of any need there for any changes?
Yes, it is. I didn't bring that up, but thank you for mentioning that. Cooper, for example, we are going to add a ingress and egress in the current, I guess you'd call it staff parking. It's a smaller parking lot that's on Marcello Drive. Currently, all the traffic has to basically go in and out one driveway. So although we're not expanding the parking facilities at Cooper, we are going to, I think, improve the way you get in and out. And likewise, at Jones, we work with Dr. Bowling, and he has a recommendation on the way he's going to dismiss students according to grade level. So we actually have an area where we're going to widen some driveways to, again, facilitate the movement of the private vehicles and try to isolate, you know, by grade level as much as possible.
That's great. That's wonderful. And then back to the buzzers that you're looking at for security. So the plan is to hopefully have all schools have these systems in place?
Yes, at the primary entrance, yes. And I guess the administrator typically would identify the primary okay. entry point.
That's excellent, because I know that's one thing that folks are concerned with. And and I love Barron's entryway. It's incredible, and you just feel so nice being buzzed in. And I think the schools have done, as I've been touring the schools through the city, they've been doing a really good job of making sure all their exterior doors are locked, you know, but the one entrance and a lot that have direct sight, like Trant, are actually locking that door too and going out and greeting folks. And then my last question is the windows that you're doing that'll conserve energy. Now, does that come into play with that energy consultant thing that we're doing, or is that somehow baselined so that?
It really had no connection with that at all. Okay. It's just that we know that the windows in many of our schools are leaky, they're drafty, they're old, they need to be replaced. But they will assist in our energy improvement in the consumption.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we have a significant heat loss, because they're all single-pane windows, for one thing. And so you have deteriorating caulking in some places and joints of some of our, what we call our round schools, which would be Smith or Machen. We have concrete arched above each window, and they have shifted over time just because of settling and movement of the building. And that disrupts the caulking and when it exposes the interior of the building, basically. So, yeah, I think the windows will definitely be a big improvement.
Yeah.
The windows will also help to reduce the strain put on the HVAC equipment as well.
Exactly.
And I think aesthetically they'll look so much nicer.
Mr. Pearson?
Yes. In the past, you've mentioned that some of your employees have been completing projects that ordinarily went out on bid, and of course, that saves us money. Is that still the case with some of these renovations?
I would say probably without exception, our employees will be involved in every one of these to a certain extent. I don't want to suggest they're taking over, say, an auditorium, but they will be involved. Typically, it's in part of the demolition effort or to salvage things that we think can be reused. But again, without exception, the maintenance people will be involved in every single project to some extent.
Thank you, Mr. Sawyer.
Thank you, Ms. Mugler.
Dr. Shiflett?
Our last report for the evening is business operations.
Thank you, Dr. Shiflett. Yes, ma'am. It's my pleasure to present to you the statement of revenues, expenditures, and encumbrances for the period ending March 31st, 2013. For the period ending March 31st, 2013, we do have our final March ADM, and as you're well aware, all of our SOQ funding is predicated upon the March ADM. Our final March ADM came in slightly lower than projected at 20,398. We were projecting 13 students more, so we missed the mark by 13 students based on the fall membership. So we're looking now at a total shortfall anticipated of about $2.4 million in revenue, but we have the attrition that will continue to, you know, offset that amount, and we'll continue to monitor that as we come in towards the year end. But for the period ending March 31st, revenues totaled $139,704,262, or $52,204,894 under the budgeted amount. Total expenditures and encumbrances represent $131,834,786. So we are in a favorable position for revenues over expenditures for the period ending March 31st. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions anybody may have.
Thank you, Dr. Hillman. Questions from board members? I think it was crystal clear.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much. Dr. Shiflett?
That concludes our reports.
We come to the hearing of any delegations or presentation of written petitions. And speakers are reminded that they limit their comments to a maximum of 5 minutes in accordance with School Board Policy BDDH. Our first speaker tonight is it's early evening, is Mr. David Dietrich.
Good evening, Mrs. Mugler, members of the board, Dr. Shiflett. My name is David Dietrich, 139 Wilderness Road. It's been nearly 2 months since I last stood before you, so we have a lot of catching up to do. I'd like to address, first of all, school safety, or what I like to call school defenseless zones. When I asked at the last meeting in February the school board's position regarding protection of our children, the response I received was we follow state law. Based on what was presented here and what I could find, there's very little in state law that actually addresses prevention of incidents like Sandy Hook or Virginia Tech. So what I have to ask, after seeing the briefing earlier on school safety, what seems to be missing there is actual prevention of an intruder entering the school and wreaking havoc like we've seen in recent years. Of all the checklists and all that were presented, I don't see anything that actually prevents a shooter who has entered the facility from doing what he intends to do. And so I'd like to know, again, based on state code, which I've read, which seems to allow options for school systems beyond what was presented here, I'd like to know if this school board and the school system intends to go any further than what was presented here. I think 12 SROs in 9 schools is nice, but I look at them as a deterrent rather than actually being able to respond and effectively neutralize a threat. And then what about those 19 elementary schools and 3 combined schools? I didn't see any discussion on that. So we have a lot of holes in our school system security-wise. The electronic security proposal looks like a good start, but again, once somebody's inside, that doesn't really help. So I'd like to see additional options discussed and presented to the public. Moving on to community engagement. I asked at the last meeting about a blue ribbon panel, and your response, Mrs. Mugler, is that you are the blue ribbon panel. Well, I think you don't understand what a blue ribbon panel is. It's an independent group that's designed to support an organization and find and reach independent conclusions to recommend changes. And so I'd like to ask once again that you consider that and implement that. Moving on to school choice that I've brought forward on many occasions. A recent Friedman Foundation for Educational School Choice report states that from 1950 to 2010, student population increased by 100%. During that same period, non-staff personnel grew 700%, so 7 times as fast. And yet there's no corresponding increase in student test scores or graduation rates. So I'd like to know how our children are being better served by such an increase in staff, and why we can't take a much broader look on how to decrease our costs in addressing those concerns. Finally, with the school budget, I've asked before who audited our school system budget for the last several years. I have yet to receive a response. And when will you produce and or justify a line item budget for public review? Just presenting your, Dr. Shiflett, just presenting your budget with what you consider will be cut if the budget isn't met, I don't think that does justice to our ability to ascertain how a budget could actually be improved. And so I'd like to ask once again also of the board, why you haven't offered up your own salaries as a budget-cutting measure. as well as those of the administrators. How do you justify pay raises across the board when the taxpayers who are paying those raises have taken cuts over during the same period for the last several years? And finally, a reading specialist at the last Hampton City Council meeting claimed that there's a lack of textbooks in the classrooms. I was informed, Dr. Shiflett, that you allocated funds for textbooks to other educational needs. Well, it seems like we're causing our own shortfalls by those decisions. I thank you very kindly for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Dietrich. Our next speaker is Chris Gaston. Good afternoon.
Hi, thank you. I'm not as tall as your other speakers. Dr. Shiflett and board and Madam Chair, thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Chris Gaston. I am an eighth grade teacher at Lindsay Middle School. My students are 13 and 14 years old. So keep that age in mind when I tell you that two of my students have been shot. Some of my students, some of the boys tell me that jail in their future is something that they're just resigned to. They tell me it's a family tradition when I question it. Some of my pupils have had a parent murdered. One boy recently told me that his great-grandmother served 7 years in prison for, or 7 years in prison. His great-grandmother. These are some of the things that my students are facing every day. These are the kind of things that they're up against. My students explained to me how the police officer can be the bad guy for them. But as Ms. Henry pointed out, that is disappearing every year with our SROs in school. I can tell you that Mr. James being in our school is amazing. He is really, truly a gift. He has that rapport that you're talking about with the students. They know him, and he's a force. He really is. You know, some of my students tell me things like they can't go into a store without being followed by a store manager. And they ask me, you know, come on, Ms. G-Money, don't you hear gunshots every night? No, darling, that's not normal. Take this armor, take these weapons, these weapons of knowledge that we're giving you, and get out of there. Go to someplace safer, get a better life. And they want to, they really do. They want to. I could cry thinking about it. They do. Most of them really want to. As a result of any kind of tight financial times, I, like many teachers, might not even be teaching in Hampton next year. I actually live in New Kent County. I drive here an hour every day. I plan to do it 1 year and move on. And I love these kids in the school system so much, I drive an hour every day. But even if I weren't living in Hampton next year, I'm a citizen of the Commonwealth. And these are my future voters, my future workforce. They're my future citizens. So I don't envy you. I know that it's hard for you all to come up with money and your backs are up against the wall, but you know, I'm a foot soldier in this. I'm there every day with them. And you know, I guess I would say for the people who say, I don't have a stake in this, I don't have a child, don't have grandchildren in school, I don't even have any children, I would say that. Here comes your workforce. Here comes your citizens. Here comes your neighbors. So they need to consider that. Just because they don't have a child in school, it's a part of their lives, and it will be. We're turning them out every year. Listen, our students need you more than ever. I think our students need you all more than some other localities. And I'm just here to ask you to do what you can to give us that armor that we can give to our kids. We really need it. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gaston. Those were the two speakers that I had received requests from. Ms. Bowers, did you receive any others? So we'll close our public comment time and move on to other items for action. We have items for action 5.01 through 5.07. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move approval of item 5.01, Special Education Annual Plan.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the special education plan as presented. Is there any discussion?
Were you not asking to approve the whole?
Well, we probably need to do these two
individually, yeah.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the special education annual plan. Is there any discussion? Ms. Bowers, would you call for the vote?
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. Item 5.02 is mathematics textbook adoption. Is there a motion?
Madam Chairman, I move approval of the mathematics textbook adoption as presented.
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Hendry and seconded by Mr. Pearson that we approve the mathematics textbook adoption. Is there any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, would you call for the vote?
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. We move now to items 5.03 to 5.07, which have to do with policy on action. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move approval of item 5.03 through 5.07.
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Phillips and seconded by Mrs. Smith that we approve items 5.03 through 5.07. Those include policy CF, school building administration, policies IGDK and JEDD, athletic extracurricular participation, deletion of school board policy IFE, curriculum guidelines and course outlines, change of school board policy EEACB, school bus maintenance to EEAC, school bus maintenance and safety, and item 5.07, new school board policy, JBAA, section 504, non-discrimination policy and grievance procedures. Is there any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, would you call for the vote?
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. We move on to deliberation. We start with item 6.01. Hampton City Schools request for waiver from science standards of learning requirements for third grade students.
Dr. Johnson is here to address any questions that you may have or to provide any information. This was given to you in the information that I sent out last Friday, and so she's here to provide an explanation and to answer questions.
Questions from board members. Mr. Kilgore?
I had one question on page 3 when you were answering the questions. It talked about the HCS Science Department will administer a summative assessment covering grade 3 science standard of learning to this group of students during May of 2014. Since this is a two-year waiver, should it say also May of 2015 as well?
Or? We can amend that so that it covers both school years.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions from board members? Thank you very much, Dr. Johnson.
Madam Chair, what I would ask, given the very short timeline the Virginia Department of Education has given us to act on this, and it does require board approval, and it is due on Monday, we would respectfully request that you make a motion to move it to the action agenda and take action on it, because we can't move forward with requesting a waiver without board approval, and we would like to do it within the timeline that the Department of Education has set.
Okay, Dr. Johnson, is there a motion?
Madam Chairman, I move that we move this item from deliberation to action.
Second.
It's It's been moved by Mrs. Henry and seconded by Mr. Kilgore that we move this item 6.01 to action. Is there any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, will you call for the vote?
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Is there a motion with respect to item 6.01?
Madam Chair, I move approval of item 6.01, HCS request for waiver from the science standards of learning requirements for third grade students.
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Phillips and seconded by Mrs. Henry that we approve the Hampton City Schools request for waiver from the science standards of learning requirements for third grade students. Any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, will you call for the vote?
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper?
Aye.
Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. We move now to item 6.02, revision of school board policy EEAD, use of school buses, and deletion of policy EEAD-R, use of school bus regulations. Is there questions or comments from board members? Mr. Kilgore?
I did have one question. Part of the deleted words out of EEAD-R referenced how the bus driver fees would be covered, and that's no longer referenced in the new wording, so I was wondering how that was covered.
Basically, the per mileage cost.
It's divided into the per mileage cost.
It is covering all the operations. That's derived from the state annual report, and it's a piece of the transportation's annual report, which encompasses all of the costs on a per mile basis. So all the overhead associated with the operation of the bus would be captured in that cost.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions or comments from board members on this particular policy? Okay, thank you, Dr. Hellman. We move to item 6.03, revision of school board policy IICA, field trips, excursions, and overnight field trips. Any questions or comments? For deliberation? There being none, we move on to item 604, revision of school board policy AD, philosophy of the Hampton School Division. Are there any questions or comments from board members on this policy? Okay, if not, we'll move on to item 6.05, revision of school board policy BCB, board officers. Any comments or questions regarding this revision? Okay, we move to 6.06, revision of school board policy BDC, closed meetings. Is there any discussion? Mr. Kilgore?
I had a couple. We do reference four Virginia codes in the text. I recommend that we include those in the legal references. It's 2.23705.1.5.6 and then 3707. They're all referenced in the text. We typically will put those in the legal references as well.
I certainly will add them.
Thank you.
Any other comments on policy BDC? We move now to item 6.07, revision of school board policies KD and BDDH. Are there any comments or questions? For clarification, Mr. Kilgore.
I had a couple requests for change in on the first page in the third paragraph down. There's a new sentence that talks about at the beginning of the public comment portion of the board meeting, the chair of the board will read a statement that describes the procedures governing public comment. I recommend that we change the word chair to clerk. And then my second comment was in the very next paragraph, I recommend that we delete the last two sentences that limit the public comment portion to 30 minutes.
Say that again.
The last two sentences say a total of 30 minutes will be allotted for public comment on the agenda. This 30-minute period may be extended at the consensus of the board. I don't think we've ever run into an issue with that, and
and frankly, I don't like the idea, you know, I think that we've always had the ability to do things if we wanted to by consensus, but that just seemed very limiting right out of the box.
We can think about that one.
Yeah, that's recommendation okay. on my part. And then my final comment was in the cross-references, now that we're changing the title of closed sessions to closed meetings, I just recommend that we make that align title-wise. That's it.
Make that align title-wise.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
We in the previous policy, we talked about changing the title from closed sessions to closed meetings, and this policy references closed sessions.
Gotcha. Okay.
So just strike sessions and
on this
meeting.
One.
Yes.
Gotcha. Other comments or questions on policy KD and BDDH? Mrs. Smith?
Yeah, I want to also agree about striking those two sentences about the 30-minute cap, because I think if folks make the effort to come out and speak, they should have the opportunity to be heard. And then I had an additional item. At the very end, it talks about the board will not respond to citizen comments at the time they're given. I would suggest adding two sentences at the very end that come from the protocol sheet we were going to read, which say matters requiring a response will be directed to the superintendent for research and response. The superintendent may report back on such matters at a subsequent business meeting session as appropriate, just to show that we will be trying to provide follow-up if that is needed or response is needed. And those were my only two comments. Did that make sense?
It's just pulled from the protocol. It's
yeah,
basically
pulling it from there into okay. the policy, so that's captured.
Okay. Other questions or comments from board members on this policy? If not, we'll move right along to item six.
Madam Chair, so those things that were just suggested, you want added, changed?
I think that means that the policy goes back on deliberation for next time, because those are changes that if it's presented as a change, then we're voting. I would think that those are substantial enough changes that the policy should go back on deliberation for next meeting instead of for action, and so we can all look at the changes. That's all.
Okay. And discuss them.
Mm-hmm. That's fine. Okay. It works for me. Is that the consensus?
Yes.
We'll go with that, Mr. Pearson. Okay, we move on to item 6.08. So we will return KD and BDDH to deliberation next week. Policy CBD, Superintendent's Contract, Compensation, and Benefits. Any questions, comments, deliberation from board members? Okay. There being none, we move on to item 6.09, revision of school board policy CBG, evaluation of superintendent, and CBG-R, evaluation of superintendent evaluation system. Are there comments or questions from board members?
What?
Yes, I'm so sorry.
That's all right.
Looking at the clock, too.
Between the two policies on there, CBG and CBG-R, excuse me, I think I'm losing my voice. The last paragraph of each of those, CBG says each board member that there'll be an annual evaluation instrument. And then in CBG-R, the last paragraph says the board will meet twice annually with the superintendent. So they're somewhat contradict each other with that wording. So my suggestion is that in CBG, we just take the very first sentence, each board member will be involved in assessing the superintendent's job performance, period, and then delete the rest of that and let policy CBGR give the detail on that, so you don't have two policies with the same information for future contradictions. And
well,
then,
may I say something? I think it's two different purposes. Okay. One is for the annual evaluation, and then in R it's talking about the mid-year review. The final.
It's not worded that way, though. It says they meet twice annually, so maybe that needs to be better explained in here? The way it reads, I understand that, but the way it reads just from a new person reading it, they look like they contradict each other. One talks about an annual evaluation, and the other talks about meeting twice annually. So maybe instead of that, the twice annually needs to be changed, like you're saying, to a mid-year and a final or something. I'm not sure what y'all think about that.
Other board members want to weigh in on that?
I think twice annually gives you some flexibility. There might be, you know, we had a different kind of superintendent. There might be an issue that came up that the board decided to have some kind of discussion with the superintendent other than at mid-year, and that then the second evaluation might take place at a different time. I think it's the idea that the board is going to give some mid-year feedback at some point, but it, you know, some intermediate feedback before a final evaluation. So if you say twice annually, you give yourself some flexibility. And there might be a situation where a superintendent came in at mid-year, or, you know, there are all kinds of, if you set yourself up a definite timetable, it doesn't always work out that way. We've had superintendents leave at odd times or
I understand what you're saying. I'm not suggesting put actual like months or detailed timeline in there. I'm just saying, instead of saying twice annually, say maybe have a mid-year and final annual.
We've had trouble with that. I think twice annually is just good to go with.
Yeah, it just contradicts the other policy is all.
I'll maybe straighten the other one out.
So what is the pleasure of the board?
Question, yes, sir. Clarification. The conflict is with the continuing basis wording or with the annual?
No, just with the annual. On the CBG, it says we'll be complete an annual evaluation instrument.
It's always annually in there.
But then the other one says you'll meet twice annually for evaluation.
It's an annual evaluation instrument.
Okay.
I'm not sure I'm understanding the conflict, because when I read it, I'm reading it as by completing the annual evaluation instrument. In other words, we establish the evaluation instrument once, and we have a requirement to provide that to her in October. I'm not seeing where the twice annually applies to that paragraph. Did that make sense?
No.
I thought initially you were talking about there was a conflict with the continuing basis verbiage.
No, where it says
the word annual.
Will be completing an annual evaluation
right.
Implies that you're going to once annually complete an evaluation. The other policy says that twice annually you're going to meet.
Okay, in the last sentence.
That's what I'm talking about.
You're talking about in the last sentence, upon conclusion of the annual performance appraisal?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, either one, because it uses the word annual twice. It says annual evaluation. Well, the annual evaluation instrument might be okay, but the annual performance appraisal, yes.
If we do it twice, if we do it annually, you don't have to call it the annual evaluation. It's the superintendent's evaluation. So if that's
just
the
get rid of the word annual.
Yeah,
that takes care of it. Yes.
So the consensus is to just strike the word annual,
where it seems to conflict with the idea of two.
Does that work for you, yeah. Dr. Shiflett? Is that sounds good to me.
Okay, Ms. Reeves, is that is. Clear as mud?
Yes, I've got it. Taking out both annuals in CBG.
Now, with that change, do we want to return that particular item to deliberation next week, or are we comfortable letting that progress?
I think we're good.
Okay, very well. We'll move on to the last item on deliberation, deletion of school board policies AFB, evaluation of superintendent, and AFB-R, evaluation of superintendent evaluation system. Any comments, questions, deliberation on this item? There being none, we'll move right along to our deliberation first read. It is a very healthy list of policies, 19 to be exact. So we'll try and charge into some of this. We'll begin with item 7.01. Revision of school board policies IBA and GBAD, neutrality of distributed materials. And we have a staff member to address this. Dr. Johnson?
Thank you, Ms. Mugler, members of the board. There's just one change, and we changed from seminars to discussions, and we added a cross-reference to a policy that we're recommending for adoption, which would be a new policy, I and B, teaching about controversial issues.
Okay, questions for clarification? There being none, we move on to item 702. Policy GBG, revision. Is that you also, Dr. Johnson?
No, that is not new, and I'm relying on Ms. Roof as I flip through these pages.
It's a cross-reference only.
Cross-reference and then some consistency in how we define division. School division so that the language and the formatting that we use is consistent. There's no other substantive changes to this policy.
Okay. Okay. Questions from board members on this item? We'll move on to item 7.03, revision of school board policy IB, academic freedom.
This is just cross-reference. As we went through our policies, we see policies that should be linked, and so we are adding cross-reference there.
Okay. Everyone good with that? Item 7.04 is a revision of school board policy IF, curriculum development.
Ms. Mugler, this policy is related to one that the board just approved to delete the language in IFE related to course guides, have now just been completely embedded so that we have just one policy under curriculum development.
Okay. Questions from board members or clarification on that item? We'll move to 705, revision of policy IGDH, extracurricular activities and athletics for students.
This policy has been updated and just reformatted under competitive sports. We wanted to make it clear that competitive sports of a varsity nature are prohibited in grades K through 7. We do begin with competitive sports for selected eighth graders, and that we just want to clarify that that participation is at their zoned high school.
Okay, any questions on that policy? Next policy is policy IGD, extracurricular programs.
And this policy is recommended for deletion, and that language will be incorporated into another policy coming before the board.
Okay. Any questions on that from members? Okay. We move on to the revision of policy AGA. And that's going to be recognition for accomplishment. Ms. Reeves?
That's simply to align. It's a since you're working on IGDH, we had to put that cross-reference because that cross-references AGA.
Okay.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Seeing the hour, I wanted to make a motion to table the rest of these policies, 7.08 through 7.19, until our next meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved by Mrs. Phillips and seconded by Mrs. Henry that we table the remaining first read items, which would be item 7.08. Is that correct?
Yes.
Ms. Phillips, 7.08 through 7.19. Is there any discussion? There being none, Ms. Bowers, would you call for the vote?
Ms. Phillips?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Harper? Ms. Henry?
Aye.
Mr. Kilgore?
Aye.
Mr. Pearson?
Aye.
Ms. Mugler?
Aye. Motion carries. I did want to ask Ms. Reeves, are there any of these that are sensitive to progressions?
They're not. There's only one that really needed to be discussed because many of them after the next item are just to align cross-references. The health and physical education one was going to be presented by Pat Thompson. I do not believe she will be available after this meeting. She is scheduled for something. So
okay.
If you want someone else to present, but she is here, if you would like to hear about the health and PE. And I know you've just voted on that, but it's at your pleasure. I can be briefed by her so we can go ahead and take care of it on her behalf, but she is not going to be available until after quite a while.
Madam Chair, if I may interrupt, I will be able to work through the health and PE policies. One thing I did want to bring to the board's attention, there is a new policy on this list that we have added cross-references to so that they could move together. So we would not be able to advance those if that policy doesn't exist.
Right.
And Ms. Reeves and I would have to go back, and we may have to bring back some that the board has taken a look at just so that we don't get them out of sequence. Because if we've added a cross-reference to a new policy and the board hasn't addressed that new policy.
Either that, or we could make a motion to progress it forward to deliberation to meet up with the other policies at next.
Okay, and we'll make sure that we link them so that that's clear.
And we would need for you to make that recommendation to us.
And we'll make that recommendation. Ms. Reeves and I will create a little crosswalk so that we keep them together.
Okay, that sounds great. I think given the circumstances, we'd be happy to accommodate that.
Thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. At this time, we will stand in recess for a brief 13 minutes until 6 o'clock, where we'll take back up with our student recognitions. Okay, we will resume with the rest of our regular business, and we will begin with recognitions, and we'll come back to information, Dr. Shiflett.
Well, actually, we could delay that, and I'll just provide it in another venue.
Okay, very well. So we'll move on to recognitions, and I will call upon Ms. Stevens-Cherry, our Executive Director of Public Relations and Marketing. She'll be assisted tonight by our school board member, Mr. Linwood Butch Harper.
Thank you, Ms. Mugler, Mr. Kilgore, members of the board, division leadership team members, Hampton City Schools family. We're very pleased tonight to call on two people who understand the importance of exceptional customer service in Hampton City Schools. I'd like two people to come forward because the people who won this award is a duo, Mr. Willie Fleetwood and Laverne Bowers. Here. A couple of years ago, this school board and the administration decided that we needed to step up our game, if you will, when it comes to customer service. Because in Hampton City Schools, as in most school divisions, everybody is your customer. So we wanted people to understand that we have valuable employees who provide exceptional customer service, which is why we developed what's called the Dove Award, which stands for dedication of our valuable employees. So we have everybody from principals to students to parents to people who come inside the building often to nominate people who they feel have shown them exceptional customer service. The only thing is when we have the school board meeting to recognize them, the recipients don't know who nominated them. So at this point, I would like to call on a parent, Ms. Chris Farrell, if she is here. There you go. Ms. Farrell was talking, we called her to tell her that her excuse me, nomination at 1, she said, I am so excited, I'm going to get a babysitter, but I will make sure I'm there. And this is what she wrote. Mr. Fleetwood drives our son's bus. This bus provides services for both the Center for Autism and New Horizons. Thus, there are two populations of disabilities on the bus, each presenting unique challenges due to their disability. Our son, who has autism, has had sensory and behavioral challenges riding the bus this year. Mr. Fleetwood has gone above and beyond the call of duty to first and foremost make sure everyone on the bus is safe. Second, working with the aide in a wonderful partnership to help our son adapt to and meet the challenges of this new situation. And third, to work with us and the school in a most heartfelt and amazing way. This bus requires constant supervision. Eyes and ears must function at 100%+, all while driving safely. He does a fantastic job with this. He has responded to emergencies and difficult situations professionally and compassionately, meeting the needs of both populations with grace and with skill. There is no other bus driver that we would want to provide transportation for our children. Thank you so much, Mr. Fleetwood. You've helped make this year so much less stressful for us. We trust you completely. Let's have a round of applause. Mr. Fleetwood. And when she wrote, she also nominated Ms. Laverne Bowers, who she says is the attendant for our son's bus. She is responsible for every single student and constantly has to observe and chart behavior for both documentation and observation per his IEP. She has responded to emergencies and difficult situations immediately, professionally, and compassionately, meeting the needs of both populations with love, with grace, with skill. We have been in the special education transportation all of the children's school careers for over a decade. We have had several wonderful attendants, but Ms. Bowers is by far the best ever. And so I am pleased at how Hampton City Schools continues to provide wonderful services for our children. Let's have a round of applause for Ms. Bowers. And we want to thank you, Ms. Farrell, because in Hampton City Schools, there are so many people providing so many wonderful services, but very few times do people take the time to acknowledge that. So thank you so much for doing that for these two wonderful people and for Hampton City Schools. Mr. Harper?
You know, folks, too often people are judged by an evaluation form, and a lot of times the person who's doing the evaluating may or may not know all that the person does. But when you're judged by the community, your friends that you work with, that's a true measure of how you're really doing. And these guys here, and you can see the emotion on her face. She just did the nominating. These are the recipients, but the nominate all. Let it flow, dear. Don't worry about it. These guys are to be exceptionally complimented for their due. Let me read this. Laverne Bowers. Are you related to
Crumbs? We're cousins. Met at the Federal Union.
Lorraine Bowers, HCS Transportation Department, presented by the Hampton School Board for exhibiting sensational customer service and for understanding the important role customer service plays in Hampton City Schools. It's dated May 1st, 2013, and I congratulate you, dear. Well, Fleetwood, yours says the same thing, but I know. But no, this guy, let me tell you. This guy is a fisherman extraordinaire. I'm the recipient. So he gives me a Dove award every time he gives me a bag of fish, already clean. But let me just say one more time, Willie Fleetwood, HCS Transportation Department, presented by the Hampton School Board for your exhibiting sensational customer service and for understanding the important role customer service plays in Hampton City Schools. And there ain't a kid that rides his bus that don't know his name, his whole name. Believe me, they know Mr. Fleetwood, they know the lady here, Ms. Bowers, and that is the true measure of how you're doing as a person in life. Not some piece of paper that people check, you know, does right, does this, ties his shoes, but people that really know what you're doing that appreciate you. Here you go, Brother Fleetwood.
I just want you to know that what I do, I truly love doing. And she's just making me cry. Thank you all.
Thank you, Ms. Farrell. I had an idea with you, but I wasn't for sure. Mm-hmm. I wasn't for sure. But this lady here, it's the backbone. Oh, my God. It's the backbone. It's the backbone. Appreciate you.
Absolutely. And before you all leave, Ms. Bowers and Mr. Fleetwood, we have these little gifts for you, each of you. And at the end of the year, there is a four-page color ad that will appear in the Daily Press with all the Dove winners, so you will be in there. Members of the family, would you please stand and be recognized? Please stand. Oh man. And we just found out that these people came to be here to celebrate in these wonderful honor. They came from North Carolina, Greenville and beyond.
Oh, that is awesome. Yes, that says a lot.
Thank you so much. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Another honor or award the school board came up with is the Creative Instruction Award. And I think somebody, Harper just said it. You can't tell everything about a person from just a sheet of paper called an evaluation. Well, you can't tell everything about the wonderful teaching in Hampton City Schools just by test scores. You really cannot. Because there's some creative instruction going on in Hampton City Schools that is second to none. And therefore, we have a Creative Instruction Award that this board presents every month at one of the televised meetings. And the winner of the Creative Instruction Award for this month, I'd like to call on Nicholas Swan from Andrews Pre-K through 8th School. Hello. I saw your picture. Ms. Height sent it to me. You did a really nice job posing. Okay. This guy, let me tell you about Mr. Swan. I feel like I know him because he was nominated by a fellow teacher called named Brian Baker. Is Mr. Baker here by any chance? Okay, I don't know if he is or not. But Mr. Baker was so excited. And I can tell you, when you have a fellow teacher nominate you, that's something. But what he said was, Mr. Swan's sixth grade science class is frequently engaged in very interesting, very cool, fun, and interactive lab experiments. This year, his students have done the following. Witnessed how rain clouds are formed, made phases of the moon out of Oreo cookies, flown paper airplanes, created a roller coaster, and had jet propulsion contests using plastic bubbles, bottles, construction paper, and plumbing tubes. Now, in our words, he is truly the epitome of a creative instructor. Let's give him a round of applause.
Hi, good evening. I'm a member of the VISTA Project, which is the Virginia Initiative for Science Teacher Advancement. And I was invited to attend the VAST conference in November in Williamsburg. It was an amazing experience, and I came away with a lot of materials that I could share with my kids to help expose them to the wonderful world of science. And I'm very grateful to be here this evening to work with the kids that I work with. My administrators are very nurturing, and this is my first year teaching, and it really makes me want to stay in it. I'd like to thank my team, Ms. Harlan and Ms. Pierce, the math teachers, Mr. Baker, of course, my mentor, and Mrs. Ruffin, the social studies teacher on our team, Ms. Hershey and Mr. Scanlon are also vital members, my instructional assistant, who is my backbone in my classroom, and the principal, Dr. Worthen, who hired me and gave me a chance. And thank you very much.
You really have to be creative to work with a bunch of sixth graders. They're out of their minds. Everything's changing, hormones are jumping, and everything's changing. And for this guy to be a first-year teacher, and it shows you what really it takes to communicate with kids. That's that creativeness, and they appreciate it. They like using their imagination skills, their creativity skills, and eventually their leadership skills. Because one of them guys will take over and be him one day, and we appreciate that. This is presented to Nicholas Swan, Andrews pre-K through 8, for having students create everything from rain clouds to roller coasters so as to ensure that sixth grade science is a wonderful experience in your classroom. May 2013, we present this to you, Russ Shaw. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mrs. Swan, do you have any family here? Do you have any family here tonight? Okay, all right. Well, we're gonna be doing an ad with your picture in the paper as well, okay? Thank you so much. Oh, Lord, he called me yes, ma'am. Okay. Now we're gonna move across to the wonderful things our students are doing. And the students who will be coming before you today are state and or international winners. I want to call on two students, Kiera Cornwell and Lexi Parsons, both from Kickatan High School. And to do it justice, I want the teacher, Whitney Kettledge, to please come forward and explain why these two people are being honored tonight.
Okay, this is Kiera Cornwell, and beside her is Lexi Parsons, and I'll start with Kiera. At our state conference this past March for DECA, Kiera presented a business plan for an entrepreneurship project, and her business plan was inspired by her father. It was very emotional for her. She wanted to start a horse rehabilitation center to help people who have suffered with PTSD and autism, and she really poured her heart into this project. And it came through with her presentation and her business plan, and it came through to the judge that she saw because she won first place. And this is a huge feat in Virginia DECA because Virginia DECA is the largest state association for DECA with over 14,000 people. So to win first place in Virginia in a category like entrepreneurship is extremely difficult, so it's a huge honor for Kiera, and we're very proud of her. Lexi has been in my class for the last 4 years, and she has always shown a great passion and a great ability to be an extraordinary leader. She served Virginia DECA for the past year as a state officer, and at our international conference this past week, she was elected as the International Southern Region Vice President. Again, this is a huge, beyond huge honor. It's really hard to even explain how big of a deal this is. Virginia has not had a national officer since 2005, and Lexi will represent over 200,000 students for the next year at the international level, so we're very proud of her as well.
Entrepreneurs, give me a job one day, all right? Good morning, y'all. Ladies, I like to read these individually, even though they say the same thing. You deserve the right to have yours read individually. Achievement, the Hammond City School Board congratulates Kiera Cornwell, Kickatan High School, first place in entrepreneurship at the State DECA Conference. This is signed by our chairman, Martha Mugler, and our superintendent, Dr. Linda Shiflett. Here you go, girl. Thank you. And again, achievement, the Hammond City School Board congratulates Lexi Parsons, Kickerton High School. She was elected International DECA Southern Region Vice Chairman, Vice President. Sorry about that. And this is also signed by our chair, Martha Mugler, and our superintendent, Dr. Linda Shiflett. Could you, did we say what DECA stands for? Please do.
Okay. So the official, like, mission statement is DECA prepares emerging leaders and entrepreneurs in marketing, finance, hospitality, and management in high schools and colleges around the globe. But it's so much more than that, and it really impacts your life. But we wouldn't have received these two awards without our amazing advisor, Whitney Kellidge. So, and you guys will see, because... You guys will see, because she's going to get recognized for Teacher of the Year for Kickerton as well. But if we didn't have such a supportive advisor supporting us, we would have never been able to do these things.
Before she makes me cry, Lexi's parents are here and her brother. And we'd also like to thank Mr. Haynes and Mr. Lawrence and Jesse White for being very supportive. And we had a very successful year, and we couldn't have done it without them. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Would the parents of these two students please stand and be recognized? We want to see you. Please stand. Come on. Oh, great. Okay. And Mr. Haynes, as always, thank you so much. And I had to look it up. Distributed Educational Clubs of America. That's wonderful. And I like just saying DECA. Okay. Thank you. Let's have another round of applause for them. And for our last two students who are going to be recognized tonight, I'd like to call on two students from Hampton High, Zania Campbell and Derek Robinson. Are they here? Okay. Yeah. Now, just as we called on the Ms. Catlett from Kickerton, I think it's important for teachers to get an opportunity to tell what their students are doing. So if Ms. Tasha Williams-Brown in the audience, please come and explain why we are recognizing these two crabbers tonight.
Good evening. I am happy to congratulate Derek Robinson and Zania Campbell, who are both senior Future Business Leaders of America. April, we traveled to Reston, Virginia. They each competed, Zania in computer applications and Derek in word processing too, and they each placed first, which earns them which has earned each of them a chance to travel to Anaheim, California this summer and compete at the national level. It's Zania's first trip with me, and this is Derek's second national attempt, where last year he placed fourth at the national level. So I have great hopes for both of them. They've been with me for the last, Derek 3 years, and I have 4 years. So it's very sad to see them go, but I know that they are going to do amazing things at their schools next year.
You guys, Mr. Fleetwood's family, these are the kind of students that we have in Hampton, right here. They're perfect examples of what our schools produce. Let me read this real quick and stop talking y'all to death. Once again, achievement, the Hampton City School Board congratulates Zania Campbell, Hampton High School, first place in word processing two. She already did one, this is two. At the FBLA State Conference and Competition, also signed by our board chairman, Ms. Mugler, and our superintendent, Dr. Linda Shiflett. Here you go, dear. Thank you. You need the space. This guy. Achievement again. Hampton City School Board congratulates Derek Robinson, Hampton High School, first place in computer applications at the FBLA State Conference and Competition. signed by Martha Mugler, Chair, and Linda Shiflett, Dr. Linda Shiflett, our school board superintendent.
Well, you know, I don't want to make anybody cry or anything, but, you know, I'd just like to thank Ms. Brown, you know, because she's like a really, really wonderful teacher, and she's like a second mother figure to me. She's like mentored me throughout all the years that I've been in FBLA and outside of the club, and I really appreciate that. Like, she's given me something to actually, like, you know, influence me to do better, because, you know, I see her and I see, like, how she's successful, how she interacts with the students and everything, and, you know, it just, like, kind of inspires me to go out and, you know, make her proud, make my family proud and everything. And it's, you know, I want to say thank you.
I would like to thank Ms. Brown for everything. Like he said, she is like a second mother. I know her on a personal level. And it's sad to see her leaving. And it's so much to say about her. She's just a great woman. Phenomenal. She's very phenomenal. And I just pray that she has the best things in life and continues to prosper. So.
The parents of these two students, if you're in the audience, please stand and be recognized. This is such a wonderful honor. Okay, see you. Okay, great. And thank you so much. Hampton High, I don't see Dr. Grove. I might have missed her. Or any Hampton High people here as well? Okay, let's have another round of applause. Thank you so much. Now, before I turn the stage over to someone who has so much enthusiasm, it will rock this house, I want to just say that Mr. Fleetwood and Ms. Bowers from the Transportation Department, you know, years ago people said that our HCS Transportation Department is the driving force behind Hampton City Schools. And we all believe that, but I would be remiss if I didn't thank the man who heads that up. Mr. Benware, would you please stand and be recognized? We want to stand because these are your people. And we appreciate what you do every day for us as well. Okay, we've heard so many wonderful things about what our great teachers are doing. Now I'm gonna turn over the stage to Ms. Joan Davis, who heads up professional development for us, to talk about three super teachers. Ms. Davis.
Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to talk to you about the three Teachers of the Year. We had the banquet last Thursday night. There are some members of our selection committee. If you would stand. And Shakisha, who was last year's Teacher of the Year. So, and you heard them say that Ms. Ketchledge was the Kickatan Teacher of the Year, and she was with her students that night rather than at our banquet. Michelle Lee is also here tonight supporting Dawn Gerbing, and she is Teacher of the Lee at Langley, and she wasn't able to attend because of a death in her family. So I'm glad you're here tonight. But I get to talk about these people. So Jessica Scott and Dawn Gerbing and Sherry Hildebrand, if you would come on up on stage with me. These three are relatively new to the teaching profession. Two of them are career switchers. Jessica, over here on the end, is from Andrews. She's a pre-K teacher. She has little ones. And tonight, she has two little girls with her who are 5 and 6. I told her she got to practice on them. And then we have Dawn, who was a labor and delivery nurse, and she literally rolled out of her last shift at the hospital to Phoenix to begin teaching there. This is her third year. She teaches the health and medical sciences. It's an elective class that's always full. And when you hear about these classes, you'll know why. Sherry Hildebrand was a marketing person and said that she had always had a dream to teach and that dream came true. She's at Bethel. And any one of these classes, you'll see why they were chosen. And you would want your children, you'd want to be in these classes, let's face it. Technology is very important in Hampton City Schools. It's very important for the world. Starting with Jessica, with her four-year-olds, they write stories on her iPad. They use the Promethean board to practice their skills. And they also use the digital camera just to take pictures of the work that they've done and cool things that they have learned. When we go to Dawn's health and medical sciences class, they're using technology also. That's where they do their experiments, a lot of experiments. Can you imagine 6th, 7th, and 8th graders learning to use a stethoscope, take blood pressure? That's what her students are doing. And in Sherry's class, she is a family consumer sciences teacher. She also has a class of students who are special needs. She has some autistic students and some ID students. And they were using the computer, and they couldn't quite remember, and you probably have this happen also, couldn't remember the difference between save and save as. Have you ever done that? Well, they were having a little difficulty, but as she was talking and talking about save and save as, she noticed that one little boy would every time she said save as, he would wave his finger. And she said, tell me why you're doing that. And he said, well, because it's in a different place. And she said, that's it exactly. So they made up a song and a finger dance to learn save as. And she says now when her kids do save as, even though they're not really using the song anymore, she'll see them go so that they know save as. So that's how technology is being used with our four-year-olds, our middle schoolers, and our high schoolers. These teachers, when I read their applications, absolutely overwhelmed me with the things that they do in their school and beyond school. They spend so much time with other things. Jessica also has basketball for the kids. She's a basketball coach. And Dawn has her students read to preschoolers at Phoenix. She also has them read to the third graders. She has clubs all over that building. And Sherry, I mean, from starting with a teacher luncheon for the returning teachers and all of the things that she does, she volunteered to do to be a chaperone at the ring dance. I was just like, my goodness, when do these ladies have any free time at all to go home and actually plan their lessons? But I know that they do. Jessica's class to teach the idea of winter, four-year-olds, remember, she took them outside so that they could feel the cold and they could see the trees and they could touch the snow. And then they came in and they drank hot chocolate. And then she read them a story about hibernation. And so they made bear caves and they sat in their bear caves and they read stories about winter. Wouldn't you like to learn about winter that way? Wouldn't that be fun? And in Dawn's class, they do all kinds of experiments. They even got to dissect a pig's heart. So middle schoolers are learning a lot about medical science, okay? And in Sherry's class, Sherry had a group of high schoolers that said when it came to a class on college and careers that they didn't really need it because they knew everything they needed to know. So she said, well, maybe you should teach the lesson then. They took her up on it. She handed them her lesson plan. And as you realize, a lesson plan is a plan. It's not a script. And all of a sudden, these students realized they were going to have to do a lot of research, a lot of things so that they could actually teach this. And in the end, they learned a very valuable lesson. And she knew they'd learned it because of her assessment came out very, very well. So I'd like you to give these three teachers a huge hand. They will represent Hampton City Schools as the elementary, middle, and high school teacher of the year for the 2013-2014 school year. And now comes that moment when we find out which one will represent Hampton City Schools as the Hampton City Schools Teacher of the Year. We have Jessica, preschool teacher, Sherry in the middle, and Dawn on this end. And they met Monday night. Banquet was Thursday night. Monday night they had grueling interviews, Mr. Haynes, 10 questions. They said they felt like they were getting ready to go to the State Department or something in order to get these jobs. So anyway, the person that the team selected was Jessica Scott. Oh, my God. Oh, come on up. She cried last Thursday too. congratulations. Husband and children are standing, right? Huh? I think you better come up. Assistant principal.
Aunt Ashley. Ooh. This crew right here is the reason I can do all the amazing things I do in my school. Ooh. Without my husband, I'm only half as good as what I can be. He supports me in everything I do. When I said I want to coach basketball, he said, okay. I said, I'm coaching Odyssey the Mind. He said, okay. I said, I'm going to head up Relay for Life. He said, okay. And that means that there are nights I come home and there's games all over the floor, but the kids are fed and they're bathed and they're in bed and their homework's done. So I can come home and I can just relax and be with him. So without my husband, I can't do all the amazing things I do. And without my daughters, I don't have somebody, it doesn't drive me to be a role model because I want to be a role model for my kids. So, and then without my amazing school backing me, I have an amazing principal and amazing assistant principals and amazing people that I work with. And then my family who's in Ohio, far, far away, who still supports me. So I have so much to be blessed and so much to be grateful for. So thank you all for such an amazing honor.
I know there are family members here for Dawn and for Sherry. Would you please stand? Mr. Saunders, others that are here, thank you. Thank you for being here.
Man, I tell you what, I get a little wet eyed myself. I don't care if y'all know it, because this is a glorious moment. Let me, for one quick second, can you hold what you have in your hands up, please? She had her keys around her neck before she came up here. That shows you the involvement. You know, those are keys to classroom and other places in the school, but that's why these people are Teacher of the Year candidates. And quite frankly, we could have a whole stage full of our HCS teachers up here, Teachers of the Year. These guys here were just chosen this time. Every time we do this, there'll be new teachers, more teachers. Not better, but definitely as good. So you got to be Father of the Year, my man. And that guy over there, the principal, used to be one of our little athletes in Aberdeen. So I'm just feeling real good tonight, y'all. And I know the young lady here, her son participated. It's just a family thing. This is what we try to instill in Hampton City Schools, a family organization for our kids, guided by people like this. So one more time, we give them a round of applause.
Thank you so much, and for everything you've seen on this stage tonight. Let's have one last round of applause as this ends our recognition.
Thank you, Ms. Stevens-Cherry. And we just, as a school board, want to, again, offer our congratulations to all of the folks who were honored tonight, those in the transportation department, our driver and bus attendant, for their great work. And we are so proud of our students and their state-level achievements and our teachers that were honored here tonight for creative instruction, as well as all of the Teachers of the Year. For their respective levels, and for our Teacher of the Year that will represent Hampton City Schools, Ms. Jessica Scott, we congratulate you and we thank you all so much for your service. You make us all look good, and we're so proud. Is there any further business to come before this board? There being none, this meeting is adjourned.